Today's video, we're going to be taking a look at the Packard Bell Legend 605.
We review old technology from games to old PCs, and don't forget the doors. Get ancient electronics, we cover it all.
Alright, so I just want to get this out of the gate at the beginning here. This might be a shorter video for the reason that this machine actually doesn't work. And I'm going to tell you that story in a minute because I know the combination of what's in there does work. I have seen this machine work not that long ago, but it has ceased functioning and I can't figure out why. I'm hoping maybe this video you guys can help me figure it out, but I'll give you that story in a moment. So. Most of us are familiar with Packard Bell. In the 90s, they got a really bad reputation. At least here in the United States, Packard Bell machines were seen as being very finicky, bad support, just not very good machines that didn't work very well. I wouldn't say they're the highest quality, but I know they've garnered kind of a cult following. In my experience, these older ones, like their 486 machines, actually don't seem that bad. It seems like it's the late 90s Packard Bell computers that seem to get the bad rap. So one other thing about Packard Bell is their naming scheme was kind of weird and sort of inconsistent. So this machine here is labeled as a Packard Bell Legend 605. But in other markets, and maybe even the same market, this could be the exact same setup and have a different name. This may have been sold as like a Packard Bell 400, or I believe the motherboard in there is known as the PB400, but it might have been sold under that name. So just keep that in mind. You might have the same exact computer with a different name. I'm just going with Packard Bell Legend 605 because that's what this particular machine is. Labeled as. So before we get into it, let me give you the lowdown of this machine. So I got this Packard Bell Legend 605 in a trade. And I got it from a guy I've known for over a decade now. He's a fellow collector or tinker with these old machines. So he kind of knows what he's doing. He knows his way around a machine. And I talked to him recently and he said this machine had worked fine with him before he handed it off to me. And I believe him 100%. So somewhere between him having it and me bringing it home, a situation developed with this machine. So basically what happened is I got it home after the trade. I plugged it in, very eager to see it work. Hit the power button, and this light right here, which is the combo turbo indicator light and just the power light, momentarily flashed. The PSU fan, you know, started spinning up for like a split second and then nothing. So my first thought is a power supply issue. So I pulled out an extra known working AT power supply, disconnected the one in there, connected the new one, and fired it up and the same issue happened. So at this point, I was a little bit disappointed. So I put everything away, set it on the shelf, and about a week later, I came back to it. I had some extra time. I was going to tinker with it. So just for fun, I kind of put it, you know, set it up, hit the power button, and it fired right up. So it fired up. It loaded right into the hard drive, no issues. And it seemed to be working fine. Now, at that point, I made a couple changes. This used to be in an adapter bay. It was right here. I took it out and I moved it here because I had plans to put a CD drive there. And I was like, all right, it seems to be working. The problem fixed itself. Love it when that happens with old computers. And a couple days I'm going to pull it back out and I'm going to take, sorry if I sound a little bit weird. My throat's a little bit sore. I'm not feeling so well lately, but well enough to do a video. But excuse me if I sound weird. But anyways, back to the story. So after a few days, I pulled this machine out again, ready to do a video on it, and I plugged it in, set it up, hit the power button, and the issue came right back. Power light blinked momentarily, fan started spinning up, immediately died, and it's never worked again since that day. So I have tried many things, and I'll talk about that in a moment. So what I'm going to do now, I'm just going to go over the machine like I normally do in a video. I'm going to look at the back, the front. I'm going to open it up. We're going to look at the inside, and then I'm going to tell you all the things I have tried to get it to work. Like I said, this will probably be a short video because obviously there won't be any gameplay footage because I can't because it's not working. But I still, you know, I figured if I never get this thing working, I still wanted to show you guys this video. And if I do manage to get it working, I'll just do a quick follow-up video with some gameplay footage going on. There's nothing spectacular under the hood of this thing. It's a pretty standard 46, well, except for one thing. But still, yeah, I would love to show you this thing running, but I can't. So without further ado, let's just take a look at the machine here. We'll start right here. We have a hard drive activity button. We have a power LED, and it's also what acts as a turbo LED, so it changes color when you hit the turbo button. Reset button and turbo button. Now these aren't actually like buttons. The buttons are behind these, and these are just like the plastic is cut down and then across and up. So they're more like tabs. And you just kind of press the plastic tab in and it hits the actual button. And then over here, here's the power button right here. And then we have the bays. We have two 5 1/4 inch and then one 3.5 inch bay. And that's fine for a 46. It actually works out really well. You get your two floppy drives and a CD drive. So that's pretty decent. You have the key lock right here. So I'm going to flip it around and then we can take a look at the back. All right, so here's the back of this machine, and we have pretty much everything built in here. So right here is our power supply, and then it even has the little connector, just standard 3-prong, but even has a little connector for the monitor if you want to connect the monitor up there. So there we have Legend 605. There's the, you know, and then we have model PB400. So let's look right here what we have built in. Alright, so the first thing we have here, we have a serial port, and then we have a parallel port, pretty standard, and then we have a game port. That's kind of slightly unusual to see built into these boards, but that's still nice. You can hook up, you know, a game controller, some you know, sort, a Gravis controller pad. Then we have built-in standard VGA, and then we have PS2 for your mouse and keyboard. That's also kind of nice for a 46 class motherboard. You don't see that a whole lot. Well, I mean, it's more common on these OEM machines, you'll see it, but it is always nice to have PS2 built in with a 486. And then you can see right away it's going to be using a riser card, and we have 1, 2, 3, 4 expansion slots, so not too bad. So I'm going to open it up now and take a look inside. This one's real easy. It's just a screw here, and then it slides forward. All right, so I have it all plugged in and set up, and I just want to show you what happens when I hit the power button. Now, you're probably not going to be able to hear the fan spin up or anything. But you'll probably just see the light flicker. So since that fateful, you know, like I said, I got this thing to work like one day, and I did power it on and power it off and power it on again, and it worked again that time. And then all I did is move it, set it on the shelf for a couple days, and it's just never worked since then. So this is what I get from that day forward. And the initial time I tested it too, this is what it did. So. And I'm gonna hit the power button right now. That's about all I get. So that brief little flicker of light. Now let me wait a second and then I'll hit it again. That's it. And I can try holding the power button in and everything. It doesn't. If I do it too soon too, after the first one, I'll get nothing. Which again, it makes me think it's the power supply, but I've tried 3 different AT power supplies confirmed working, and I get the same issue. So I don't know. I'm not like a electric, what do they call them, electronic engineer or anything like that. So I have no clue. All right, and here's the machine with the lid taken off. Right away, you can see this thing has been upgraded. Like I said, the guy I got this off from the trade, usually all the machines I've gotten off him in the past, he upgrades them to the max. That's part of his tinkering that he likes to do. So I expected to get this machine fully upgraded. It's always a cool thing when, we do a trade or I buy or get a machine off him. Let's take a quick look at this. Obviously, 1.44 megabyte floppy drive, 1.2 megabyte floppy drive here. The hard drive, I don't know if this is the original drive, but it's a 425 megabyte drive from. So this is Western Digital, 425 megabyte drive. Like I said, that time I got it to work, it did boot right into it. We have the floppy and IDE right on the motherboard. Battery, I believe he replaced it with a new battery. So I don't think a battery would be the issue. That looks new, and I am pretty confident that he probably desoldered the old one and soldered on a new one. Riser card. Now, unfortunately, it is only 16-bit ISA. There is no VLB or anything like that. Just 16-bit ISA. So look at the board here. The CPU, the original CPU it came with, is this guy right here. Now this is an Intel 46SX at 25 megahertz. So this is the low end, with the slower 46 CPUs. It also does not have the math coprocessor built in. But fortunately, this board does have, as you can see here, a upgrade path for your CPU. In a little upgrade slot right here. Now this isn't the kind that have the little lever that make it easy, unfortunately. So you gotta if you have a CPU in there and you want to take out, you gotta pry it out, unfortunately. But you could either put a 487 math coprocessor in there, which is probably not the best idea, or you could just put a DX processor in here with the math processor built in. Basically, when you put that chip in there, it deactivates this one. So right here, what we have in here is a Intel Overdrive. So this is the PR100. So this is basically a 100 megahertz CPU. So that's quite an upgrade. So we go from this SX running at 25 megahertz, we go all the way up to 100 megahertz CPU. So this is running on a 33 megahertz front side bus timed 3. And this has all the voltage regulation and stuff built into it. So this is just kind of like a drop-in CPU upgrade. Now you do have to set jumpers. You have to change the bus frequency to 33 megahertz. I believe this jumper right here you have to put on to activate the CPU upgrade slot. So if you this jumper is removed, it just uses the soldered on CPU. When you put the jumper on, it knows to look at the upgrade slot there. So that's a nice upgrade. I wanted to do some like comparisons to show you guys what like how big of an upgrade that is as far as speed goes, but fortunately, I can't do that now. Another thing about this slot is from my research, I believe it is incompatible with the Pentium overdrive. So if you have one of those 83 megahertz Intel Pentium overdrives, I haven't tried it, but from what I've read on the internet, it will not function correctly in this slot. So that's a bit of a bummer. So this might be about the best upgrade you can put in here. Or maybe one of those Kingston overdrive chips that use the AMD 5x86 that's running at 133 megahertz. I suppose that would be a little bit faster of an upgrade, but this is almost about as high as you can get. But I would guess one of those AMD upgrade chips would work in here fine as well, as long as it had the voltage regulator. Actually, I have one of those chips right here. It's non-functioning, so I just kind of use it as wall art, but this is one of those CPUs that uses the AMD 5x86 at 133 megahertz, and it has all the voltage regulating stuff on the chip. Unfortunately, it doesn't work. Right here, we have your onboard L2 cache and the tag RAM right here. This is maxed out right now to 256K, which for a 486 class machine, that is perfectly fine. You start to get diminishing returns after 256k of L2 cash. That is nice. So right here is RAM. I believe the max for this motherboard is 20 megabytes. I mean, that's enough for a 486 type machine, but it is a little bit of a weird number. Usually in a 486, you at least see it able to take, 32, 36 megabytes, 64 even. So, that's a little on the low side, but it's still fine. I believe the vast majority of games that will play on this machine should work fine. I don't recall what he has in there now. I would assume it's maxed out at 20 megabytes. So, this looks like the memory that's soldered on. I believe this is system memory, but I don't know how much it is. So, I don't know. I can just tell you from the data sheets, I believe 20 megabytes is the max. Off on it. Yeah, I'm looking here. Yeah, it looks like, 20 megabytes right there. So, and finally, we have the built-in video, and the built-in video is from Oak Technologies. Looks like a OTI-077, I believe. And I believe you can upgrade this to a full 1 megabyte, which I believe he has upgraded it to the full 1 megabyte of memory. From my experience with Oak video cards, they're like low-end to mid-range. But I think in general they're just regarded as kind of mediocre video cards. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I can't really think of any of these Oak video cards or video chips that stand out in the market. They just tend to be kind of middle of the road video chips. So yeah, that's about all for the board. It really has all you need built in except for sound. So if you had one of these machines, you would definitely want to put in a sound card. I believe he originally had a ESS audio drive in here, which is a great choice. I haven't played around with those cards. I removed it since this machine isn't working. But yeah, you would want to put in a sound card. And you might also want to consider putting in a video card, because you definitely can do better than this built-in Oak video chip right there. So what have I done to troubleshoot the problem? Well, everything I can think of. I've tried disconnecting everything, basically. Disconnecting these drives, trying to power it up, no difference. I've pulled this CPU and I've reseated it with no change. I've pulled this CPU and tried setting it up so it will use the original CPU and, lowered the front side bus and everything. Same issue. I have tried at least three different AT PSUs. Same issue. I've actually took this machine over to a friend's house. He has a better workspace. And we put it on his workbench and opened it up and tried messing around with it and things like that, and trying different video cards, and double checking, triple checking the jumpers, and reseating everything, and different power supplies. No, can't get it running again. I've reseated the RAM. I've tried different RAM. Like I said, it doesn't even give me a speaker beep. Now I've checked the, I believe right there is where you can set the speaker, so you can hook up in an actual speaker cone if you want to. So right there, you can actually hook up an actual speaker there if you want to, and you can move this little jumper here. But where it is right now, the internal piezo speaker, which is right there, is selected. I get nothing from that. I've tried many things. I even tried, I was thinking maybe it was a short, like something touching underneath. I've physically, I've taken the riser car off. I've unscrewed, I've actually physically moved the board, taken the board out. It just doesn't work. The board might just be shot, which is unusual because it worked, and all I did is set it on the side, and then when I came back to it, it just never worked again. So yeah, it's one of life's great mysteries, I guess. So I would assume if it did work, it could be made into a pretty nice 486 gaming machine. It is pretty small. I like how it has a lot of built-in, the PS2 ports built-in is great. You got to throw in a sound card Maybe a video card if you want better performance and, you know, with video. I do like that you can really upgrade the CPU fairly easily. You could throw in one of these overdrives. Can't throw in a Pentium overdrive as far as I can tell, but one of these, overdrive chips should work just fine. Even if you don't want to go that far, you could just throw in like a DX2, 66 megahertz DX2. You could get a really good, really good 46 gaming machine out of this Packard Bell. But hey, maybe that is a Packard Bell thing. It just doesn't work. We don't know why. So maybe I guess that doesn't help the reputation of Packard Bell. Even these old machines. I know I've heard them even referred to as like Packard Hell. So that's a shame, because it really looks like it could be a decent 486. So I guess I'm going to end the video there, since I can't do any, you know, games or anything like that, show you any footage of it running. So yeah, give me any ideas or suggestions in the comments below. Do you have this machine? Has it worked fine for you? What do you think about it? If you have any ideas of what could be wrong and what I can do to try to fix it, let me know. But other than that, I guess it's just going to go back into the storage unit. So thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.